Hey family, Pastor Touré here. I'm excited about this message you're getting ready to watch. It's going to bless your life. And there's another blessing that I pray that you'll be able to avail yourself to. I wrote my second book called Wholeness, Winning in Life from the Inside Out. This book is going to change your life. It's all about identifying and uncovering some invisible boundaries that keep you from your potential. It's a great blessing with a foreword even from our Bishop T.D. Jakes. Enjoy it. But for now, enjoy this video.
Yeah, your worship doesn't have to stop just because the music stopped. It doesn't have to end just because the worshipers are no longer on stage, because I just am crazy enough to believe that there are some worshipers in the pews that if they had no music and they had no microphone, that God has done enough for them that they could worship all by themselves if they have to. If I never opened the Bible and I never got to my points, that he's been so good to you that you could worship in this room all by yourself, that when you look back over what you've gone through and how you should have lost your mind, somebody shouldn't even be in this room, but because he is so awesome, he made a way out of no way. Because he is so awesome, cancer couldn't hold your body. Because he is so awesome, heartbreak couldn't stay in your vicinity. Because he is so awesome. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you. We make a demand on the spirit that is hovering over this place to inhabit the praises of your people. We worship you, oh God, not because we deserve it, not because we've been so good, but because you've been that good. In spite of what we've done, in spite of the thoughts that have roamed through our head, that you saw fit to bless us anyway. I wish I had some old school church people in here. I'm sorry, I'm young, but I grew up in the old church where they would just start calling on the name of Jesus because they believe that demons started trembling, that every knee would have to bow. I dare you to tell your depression Jesus has already overcome. I dare you to tell your situation how awesome your God is. I know the odds may look like they're stacked against me, but they're never stacked against the God that I serve. There is purpose over my life. There is clarity in my next move because the God I serve wouldn't get me this far and then leave me. You are in the right place at the right time for the breakthrough that you've been praying for. I'm going to say it one more time, because when your hunger meets his anointing, radical things start breaking out. This isn't the cute Christian moment. Y'all can stay seated down. This is for the people who need God to move in their life. God, if you don't do it, it cannot be done. God, if you don't break loose, it will not happen for me. I make a demand on the anointing. This is a job for Jesus. This is a job for Jesus. So I'm crying out for the King of all kings, because I know when I am outmatched. This is a job for Jesus. I need you. I need clarity. I need focus. I need passion. I need to forgive. This is a job for Jesus. I can't do it by myself. A drink can't give me this. A blunt won't do it for me. Can I talk to some real people who have been in the highways and byways, who searched high and searched low and still couldn't find anybody who could do it like Jesus? Thank you, Jesus. We exalt your name in this place. You are our healer. You are our provider, oh God. You make all things work together for our good. God, we worship you. You are excellence. You are almighty, oh God. You are power. You are strength. You are peace. You are joy. We exalt your name in this place, oh God. We bring to our remembrance just who you are. Oh God, we exalt you. We exalt you. We exalt you. We exalt you. Over our children, we exalt you. Over their schools, we exalt you. Over their minds, God, we exalt you. Over our marriages, our wives, our husbands, oh God, we exalt you. Over this church, oh God, over this church, we exalt you. We lift your name on high. We lift your name on high. God, we've gathered in this room because we believe where two or three are gathered, that you will be in the midst. My God, thousands have gathered, so certainly you are here. Certainly you are here. This is the environment where miracles can take place because we gather together. If someone's at a sports game and somebody's at a concert, but we are gathered here under the name of Jesus. And somebody may win or lose the game, but in this room, we are already victorious. Someone may lose or win at the concert, but in this room, we've already got the victory. And somebody just needed a reminder that I've got the victory. I don't care what confusion says. I don't care what CNN says. I know the God I serve, and I've got victory. So God, help us tap into that victory. God, you've already decided to do something in this room. So we bring ourselves into alignment with what you have already decided to do. Let this moment not fall short of what you've already designed. Break down every wall, every barrier, any thought that would keep us from all coming together and receiving what you have already destined for this moment to be. God, I decree clarity in this room. Focus in this room, that you're going to stir up gifts that some people thought were dormant in this room, because that's the kind of God you serve. So God, I yield myself over to you and I say, have your way. Let it not be me up here, but let it only be you. No nerves, no fears, nothing but what you've already given me, God, and may it pour out so smoothly and so succinctly that it hits everyone in this room exactly where they are. We receive it, we believe it, we make a demand on it. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Listen. I'm gonna get right into the word. Matthew 28, 1-8 is my text. Some of you may not have your word. That's okay, because we have jumbo screens to the right and to the left of me that would allow for you to read along. My husband has this anointing. We're going to call it an anointing, where he reads and preaches the word at the same time. But God has been dealing with him on that. I don't know if you all have noticed, but he just reads through right now. He is a God of transformation. Amen. Because I don't always wear the right shoes for when that happens, you know, so I had to take my shoes off in the middle of him reading the scripture sometimes. Because I'm not going to sit, because that's my man. I got to support my man now. Amen. Matthew 28, 1-8. And the text begins, it says, now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. His countenance was like lightning and his clothing as white as snow, and the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the woman, the angel answered, the woman never asked a question, but the angel answered and said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He's not here. The Jesus you are looking for, he's not here. You're looking for the wrong Jesus. I want to introduce you to a risen Jesus. He's not here, for he is risen as he said. He did exactly what he said he was going to do. Come, see the place where the Lord lay. Come, see for yourself, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And indeed, he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, and ran to bring his disciples word. If I may take a subject for today, it would be undefeated. Undefeated. The reigning champ undefeated. And so, God, we thank you. I want to sit beside him one time at church because, like, he is the amen corner. If don't nobody else get it, my man, I know he got me. Amen. I cannot wait. God, thank you for what you're doing in this place. We receive your word. Let it be a blessing to your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I like it. There was a 12-year-old boy riding a bicycle through Louisville, Kentucky. He was riding his bicycle around Louisville, and he heard that there was an exhibition taking place. And at this exhibition, they would be giving away free popcorn and hot dogs. And so he did what any child would have done. He dropped his bicycle and went running into the exhibition. The only problem is when he came out, his bicycle was stolen. He loved this bicycle. This was his favorite bicycle in the world. He was so distraught that when a man was passing by and noticed that he was upset, he told him to go tell the local police officer who hung out at the gym. He runs into the gym, and instantly the smell of sweat and people boxing in the ring distracted him so much so that he forgot about his bicycle. And all of a sudden, he was enthralled by this idea of boxing. That 12-year-old boy, his name was Cassius Clay. Cassius Clay, he was such a phenomenal boxer that he would say things like, I said I was the greatest before I even knew it. Ali, the greatest boxer alive. He was radical. Everything Ali did was radical. Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. He would get in the ring and do the Ali shuffle and stick his chin out and mock his opponent because he was radical. He just believed that he was the greatest to ever do it. He wasn't just radical in the ring, though. He was radical about everything. I read somewhere that when he was going to the Olympics to fight, that he was so afraid of flying that he went to the Army surplus store and bought a parachute because he's radical. He's like, I'm not going to miss out on the Olympics, but just in case this sucker decides to not make it to the Olympics, I'm going to have a parachute. He was so radical that when everyone else was getting drafted and going to serve their country, that he took a radical stance that cost him his title and time out of the ring. He was radical. The only issue with being radical is that you're never just halfway radical. Radical people are always all or nothing. I'm kind of one of those radical people. Like somebody watches HGTV and they say, you know what, I'm gonna call a contractor. And I say, I'm gonna go to Home Depot because I can do all things through Christ. And it's only halfway through the project where I realize sometimes all that you can do is call a contractor to actually do it right. But I'm radical. And I don't halfway do anything. Do I have any radical people in the room? Like, you don't just love somebody. You go all the way in. You are loyal. Don't talk about them in front of my face because I am radical. Problem with being radical is that radical people are often radically disappointed as well. Where someone else could just say, oh, that's the way people are and keep on pushing. When you are radical, it hurts you deeply. I love this text because we're getting to have an encounter with a risen Jesus and Mary, who was Mary Magdalene. She was radical. Mary Magdalene didn't just have one demon. She had seven of them, okay? She was radical. When Jesus healed her, she didn't just say, oh, thank you, and go back into her life. She was so radical that she started following him everywhere she went. She said, I just can't receive from you and just go back as if life never happened. I'm radical about what just took place with me. And so she followed Jesus even to the cross. She was radical, but at this time when we find her in the text, she's having to be radical after loss. Yeah, Jesus has been crucified. The one who healed her, the one who saved her, is now dead. And she's having to be radical. So radical that even though the tomb is closed and the stone has been rolled over, there's something about her that says, I'm going to go anoint his body with oil and spices. And so she starts making her way to the tomb, not even knowing how the stone was going to be rolled away, but that didn't matter to her because she was radical. Have you ever had to maintain that radical spirit even after loss? Like when you're trying to love again after heartbreak. I'm trying to still be radical about this job the way I was when I first got on board, but now I understand the politics behind the job, and it's a little bit difficult to be radical the way I once was. I'm trying to be radical in my relationship with God, but it's hard to be radical in my relationship with God because I keep on experiencing disappointment after disappointment. How do you maintain that spirit of being radical after loss? So I love the text. It begins that it's after the Sabbath and she's on her way to the tomb. And there was a great earthquake, which I love because this earthquake was a sign that she wasn't just being radical on her own, but that she also served a radical God. I love that she has this encounter where she realizes that she also serves a radical God, because I think that there's something supernatural that happens when radical people get saved. You see, because you got to be careful when you start judging radical people. Because if they're radical in one area, maybe they're radical clubbing, maybe they're radical on the workplace, but God knows that if he can touch the heart of a radical person, that they would turn his kingdom upside down because they are radical. Somebody here has been carrying the shame of once being radical for all the wrong reasons. And they're wondering if there's any place for them in the kingdom given the past that is behind them. And I hear God saying that because you were radical, that's why I saved you. Because I wanted to take that spirit and start turning it and transforming it for my glory. God uses radical people. He uses everybody, but there's something about radical people. I'm reminded of the Apostle Paul, who was once persecuting Christians, but he had an encounter on the road to Damascus, and all of a sudden he became so radical about Jesus. You got to be careful when you start judging radical people, because just because they aren't radical in a way that you don't understand doesn't mean that they aren't radical in a way that God can use. So the next time you see someone being radical for all the wrong reasons, instead of judging them and persecuting them, I dare you to start saying, I hope and pray one day that you take that radical spirit, that rebellious spirit that is down on the inside of you, and start turning it for the purposes of God, that you would become radical about your education, that you would become radical about what God wants to do in your life, just like Mary Magdalene. And so in this text, I love it. It continues and it says that Mary was trying to remain radical, and she was headed to the tomb, and there was an earthquake. And when this earthquake happens, things begin to shake up, and the angel of the Lord descends from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door. I love this because Mary Magdalene was headed to the tomb with no idea how the stone would be rolled away, but God already had a provision for her. And the provision came in a way that she would least expect. I kind of feel that strongly for somebody. Somebody has not been going to do what God told them to do because they don't know how the stone is going to be rolled away. What is the stone? You don't know how you're going to get the loan for the business. You don't know how you're going to get the job. You don't know if you're going to be able to apply for school. So you've got this wait and see mentality. I'll wait to move on what God told me to do when I know how the stone is going to be rolled away. But when you start walking by faith and not by sight, you start doing crazy, radical things. I believe that somebody has lost that radical nature, that fire that was burning down on the inside of them. Like when you first got saved and you couldn't wait to witness it, anybody who came your way, that someone has lost that ability to be radical. And I feel like this word is for them, because God was showing Mary that because you were radical about staying devoted to who you are and devoted to what I was doing, then I will open up the windows of heaven. I will cause a great earthquake and roll away the stone that you are afraid of. God is, I hear it so clearly, God is saying that I've already gone ahead of you. I don't know who's battling with something in this room. Somebody's been worried about how they're going to make ends meet. Somebody's going to be been worried about how the move is going to make sense. And I hear God saying that I've already rolled the stone away, that I'm just waiting for you to get into position to see that I've already done it. So Mary Magdalene, she's walking to the tomb, and the stone is covering the tomb. But God didn't allow the earthquake to happen before she got there, not one moment before she got there, because he wanted her to see that he can go ahead of her and make the crooked path straight. He wanted her to see that there was some, God wants to open your eyes to what he can do when you start walking by faith. God wants to open your eyes about what he can do when you start walking by faith. Oh man, I gotta say that thing the way that I see it, because I feel like there's this war right now going down on the inside of you about how it's gonna happen and how it's gonna shake out. And I hear God saying that when you move, I move. That when you move, I move. When you start walking like it's already done, then I start rolling stones away. That God is not going to roll away stones while you sit down. That God said that when you start walking, that's when I start rolling. When you start walking, he starts rolling. His pace is greater than your pace. But I'm not going to waste my time and my energy on people who are praying for things that they don't really want to happen. If you really want it to happen, start making the business plan. Stop praying and waiting for somebody to give you something and start getting radical. I mean, start saying stuff like, I am the greatest before I even knew I was the greatest. That I'm healed even when the doctor says that there's a disease in my body. That when you start walking, I start rolling. My marriage is fine. I know it looks like it's on the brinks right now, but because I walk by faith, I believe that when I start walking, stones start rolling. I feel like somebody forgot the weight of their steps when you walk by faith. Somebody forgot the weight of their steps because you had so much disappointment and it's been so difficult to be radical after loss that you forgot the way God would move and all you had to do was whisper a prayer. That you forgot how God would start doing things on your behalf that you didn't even ask him for. You forgot the weight of your steps when you walk by faith. That when you walk, stones roll. That when you walk, your children are saved. That when you walk, mountains start moving because you had that mustard seed faith. I'm sorry, I'm going to move on to my next point. I have a lot of them, but I feel like I can't move on until somebody starts walking with weight again. That you start walking like no weapon formed against you will prosper. Like you start walking like though he slay me, yet shall I trust in him. Like when you walk into a room, angels came in with you. Like when you walk into a room, demons start trembling. Like when you pray for that child, they must be saved. Like when you pray for that church that things must come together, that you have forgotten the weight of your steps and God wants to return to you. Them radical steps. Them prophesying over dry bones steps. Them I'm gonna be okay regardless of what it looks like steps. You are weighty. You are more weighty than you realize. Because the storms come and we're tossed to and fro. And for a minute, we can feel like we aren't in control of our own lives. And you aren't when you're doing it by yourself. But when you are partnering with God, your steps have weight. When you are partnering with God, your words mean something. When you are partnering with God, your prayers back in heaven, you got weight on your steps. Even when you're radical after loss, you're still weighty. Oh, Jesus, I feel it. You think you lost something, and you think in the process of losing something that you lost your weight. But I came here to tell you, if you don't hear nothing else, that I don't care who walked away from you, I don't care what job you didn't get, that you are still weighty in spite of the things that you lost, that you are still a heavy hitter in the kingdom, in spite of what divorce happened, in spite of what mistakes took place, you are a heavy hitter in the kingdom. And when God awakens you to the fire that he placed down on the inside of you, I hear stones rolling out of your way. I hear insecurities rolling out of your way. I hear fear rolling out of your way. I see demons moving out of the way. I see doors opening that shouldn't even be open because you remembered that you were weighty. You remember that when I get in my prayer closet, when I start calling on the name of Jesus, there's a weight behind this thing. I know I've been down. I know I've been depressed, but I just got my weight back. Get your weight up. Come on, somebody. Get your weight up. We didn't come here to play. We didn't come here to exist. We came here to get our weight up. We came here to serve notice on the enemy. We came here to serve notice on every plot and plan of the enemy. I'm weighty. You don't like me, that don't scare me. I'm weighty. You don't get me, that don't bother me. I'm weighty. Whether you like it or approve of it or not, I'm weighty. You walk into a room and the atmosphere shifts because I'm weighty. I'm weighty, I'm weighty, I'm weighty. I'm sorry, I'm gonna move, I am, I promise. I got plenty of points, but I feel like I can't move until somebody fully gets their weight back. I have to tell you this. When I was studying and I was looking up Ali's career, I thought for just a moment that he was the greatest because he had never lost. And then I realized that he had lost. And I thought, how are you the greatest but you lost? And I realized that even though he had lost, that he wasn't defeated. He was undefeated in spite of his losses. I don't mean because of a record. I mean because of a mentality. That even when I lose, I win. And I believe that God wants to give you the mindset of being undefeated. That you recognize that you have weight even when you lose. That you are still the righteousness of God even when things aren't shaking out the way you thought they would. That you are undefeated. I prophesy and decree and declare that the people who are hungry enough to be weighty in seasons of loss, that they will be undefeated. That when it's all said and done and the history books are written and the eulogy are given from this stage, that they will not say that I had it all together, that they will not say that I did everything the right way, but they will say I was undefeated, that I took a loss and still won, that I came out on the other side in spite of what I went through. I may have been lost in one season, but I was undefeated in the next because all things work together for my good. I'm undefeated, baby. I'm undefeated. I'm divorced. I didn't do everything the right way, and I'm still undefeated because the God I serve takes the things that I made a mess of, and he turns them into a masterpiece. I'm sorry. I'm undefeated. I wish I could make you feel better about your wins, but all I'm focused on is mine. I'm undefeated. I don't mean that in this arrogant way. I mean this in this confidence way, that I'm partnered with a radical God, and he took a radical Sarah, and when we got together, we were an undefeated team. We were an undefeated team. Okay, I'm gonna get to my notes because the visitors don't know what's going on, and y'all done got me all excited. All right, and then radical Mary, and then all right, radical. All right, I'm gonna give you 30 seconds to get a praise break while I get back on track about being undefeated. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I want you to start praising Like the area where you thought you were lost, losing in, you actually just found out that you're undefeated. You actually just found out that the fight has been fixed. You actually just found out that depression can't hold you. I want you to start praising. Just 30 seconds while I find my notes, I just want you to have a moment with your undefeated partner, your undefeated teammate. God, you got the victory, so I am undefeated. Yeah. Yeah. And so, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were headed to the tomb. They were headed to the tomb to anoint the body of Jesus with no idea how the stone would be rolled away. And they got there and God timed this earthquake and this angel descending out of heaven just in time for them to see that they were worried about something that God already had a plan for. That they were worried, but God had already created a provision. And I love this because Mark, you know, the Gospels are all parallel. And so Mark gives us even more insight into this moment. But I love this because when Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were worried about the tomb, they never once considered the guards. But God already had a plan for the surprises too. Yeah, the surprises, because you know what keeps most of us from pursuing what God has for us? It's not just the stone, it's the idea of the surprises. Because when you've been surprised before, it makes you worried about what surprises could lay ahead. Yeah, it's one thing to be prepared for the stone, but what about the guards? What about the guards that stand in the way of destiny? The guards, like I never thought that I would get pregnant, but there was this surprise, this thing I could have never planned for that was standing in the way of what I needed to accomplish. And I'm here to tell you that God didn't just kill the guards. He didn't just make the guards disappear, but he had shook the guards so greatly that they fell out almost as if they were dead. I love this because what it says to me personally as I walk in this journey, listen, we moved to Denver. We didn't know what surprises were going to be here in Denver. Okay, we knew it was going to snow. All right. That was my stone, amen. That was my Denver stone, the snow, okay? But we didn't know who you were. We didn't know who was going to be for us and who was going to be against us. And we could have said, I'm not coming because I don't know what surprises lay in wait for me. But when you get an undefeated mindset, you don't even care what the surprises are. Because you recognize that when you operate and function in the will of God, that any tongue that rises up against you, he will condemn. That means that God already has a provision for the stone you can see and the guards that may surprise you. What am I telling you? I'm telling you, don't let your mind run off into the what ifs and the possibilities and keep you stagnant in a season when you're supposed to be walking. What I'm telling you is that if there is a what if, and if there is a possibility, that God already knew that it may take you by surprise, but it will not take God by surprise, because when he rolls the stone away, it's going to shock the guards in such a way that even they have to back up. When God makes a way for you, not even your naysayers can keep you from laying hold of what God has for you. God is not going to take a vote before he blesses you. He's not going to ask the people who are talking about you, is it okay if I roll the stone away? No, he's going to roll the stone away in such a way that they have to back up and say, I don't know what just happened. But God just made a way, so I had to move out of the way too. You don't have to be afraid of the surprises. I'm falling in love. I want to get married again, but I'm not sure if he's going to turn the other cheek. But I'm not afraid of the surprises because I believe that God brought this person into my life. I had to raise this child on my own, but I'm not going to be afraid of the surprises and the what ifs and the possibilities because I know God has already created a plan for the surprises. I got to apply for school. I don't know whether or not I'm going to get the grades or I'm going to get the financial aid. I can get into school, but I don't know if I can stay in school. Maybe I shouldn't go at all. God said, I've already got a plan for the surprises. And if you would ever become more radical about how you're going to win than you are about all the ways you could lose, then you could channel all of your faith and all of your vision and all of your creativity. Sometimes we spend more time creating all the ways we're going to lose than we do trying to figure out what we're going to do when we win. And so we don't create an environment for blessings and miracles to take place in our life because your doubt kills the miracle before it can even give birth. We got to be undefeated. No, yes. Yes. I'm telling y'all, that's the amen corner. I'm moving my seats. I need to talk to security. Listen. Verse 5 says, after the guards are on the ground, man, this is a plot twist if ever there was one. Because God has Jesus, he's already risen from the dead. God has gone ahead of her. He sent an angel. The path is clear for her to anoint the body of Jesus. The only problem is the body isn't there. The body isn't there. I finally got my mindset together. I'm finally on track. God opened the doors, but what he opened the door to wasn't exactly what I thought it was going to be. Man, I was looking for the crucified Jesus. So now you're telling me that he was undefeated. And that's great, but the only issue is that I'm only used to connecting to a crucified version of who he is. So in order for me to connect with the risen Jesus, I'm going to have to change who I am. I'm going to have to change the way I do things. I'm going to have to change the way I communicate with people. In order for you to access God in this next dimension, you are going to have to change. You see, the reality is that Mary Magdalene had been filled with Jesus on that level. And now she was going to have to elevate to the next level, but it was going to have to require her to change. Has God ever moved on you? You used to just two worship songs, a hand clap praising, and you shout all over the church. But now I feel like I need something deeper. I used to connect with him on one level, but now I feel like I need something deeper. Mary Magdalene was forced into deeper. And she was forced into deeper because she did not get what she thought she was going to receive. When God disappoints you, it's to grow your faith, not to shut you down. When life disappoints you, when he doesn't answer the prayers that you... See, had he answered Mary Magdalene's prayers, Jesus could not have been risen. Man, that's heavy. If he would have done what Mary asked him to do and had the body in the tomb, then Jesus would have never been risen. Which means that God didn't really disappoint her. He elevated her mindset. Because I can do exceedingly abundantly above all that you may ask or think. What does that mean? That means the areas in your life where things didn't work out actually worked very well. That means the areas in your life where you feel like you have regret or resentfulness or bitterness because you sowed into an idea that didn't work out, that God said that you have not lost your seed. I just changed the way you would receive it. You didn't lose, I just changed. And so I love this because it starts and the angel tells to her, don't be afraid. So I thought that he was saying, don't be afraid because the stone had rolled away. But the next few words reveals to us that what he was really saying is, you don't have to be afraid because you have not lost Jesus. Oh, I love this. Oh, I love this. Because we go through these seasons where we can't connect with him. You know, not like the way we used to. And a part of us starts to worry is, have I lost something? I used to be able to really worship. And now I just do it because Pastor Brian says, lift your hands. I used to be able to really hear from God, but for some reason, I can't hear from him the way that I used to. I used to love God, but now I feel like I don't even know him. I can't see his hand in my life anymore. And I hear God saying, don't be afraid. That you're seeking Jesus on one level, and I'm telling you that he is elevated to another level, but he's not going to leave you there. He's going to elevate your faith too. And when he gets finished, you're not just going to have faith for stones to be rolled away or for guards to be lying down in fear. You're going to have faith that God can take your dream and multiply it in a way that you couldn't have done on your own. That he could take the body of Jesus and allow it to be risen is a sign to me. That he can take the idea of us coming to Denver and multiply it with people who had been praying that we would come here. And multiply it with people who understood the grace and anointing that was on this house and was locking arms until leadership came in. God has already elevated the thing that you were praying for. It's just going to be delivered in a package that you didn't expect. You praying for a boo? God has a man of God for you. You praying for a job? God has put entrepreneurs down in your spirit. You're praying for something that God has already multiplied. And because you had the faith to walk into it, multiplication is coming to you. Man, I don't know who that is for. And I promise you, just like I moved on before, I'm going to move on again. But I'm telling you that God has already multiplied the thing that you have been praying for. Some people needed their faith back. Somebody else is already at the tomb and wondering what happened. I had the faith to get in the room, but I don't see it the way I thought it was going to be seen. And I'm telling you that God multiplied it. You can't see it because you were looking for one version of it. But God said, I have multiple versions of what I want to do in your life. I have multiple options on how I want to bless you. I've got multiple options on how I'm going to save that child and change that child and transform them. I got options. I can't say it the way I feel it, but I feel like God has multiplied the thing that you've been praying for. That it's bigger than what you thought. And so I had to disappoint you on one level so that you could dream bigger on the next. You're undefeated is what I'm saying. I just keep going back to the topic. You're undefeated. Even when you lose, you're undefeated. Even when it's not who you thought it was, you're still undefeated. God has multiplied that thing, that gift, that anointing, that idea, that power is already multiplied in heaven. All you have to do is bring your mind into the consciousness of my partner is undefeated. So even when I don't understand what's happening on earth, my partner in heaven is undefeated. So I am too. Okay, I'm coming to a close, so Pastor Craig, don't pull me off the stage. Okay, so he's not here, he's risen. Come see the place where the Lord lay. Sometimes you gotta see that disappointment. You can't just move on. If we don't start dealing with the things that disappointed us and start understanding how it changed us and made us bitter, then we're going to be moving but still stagnant. You're going to be still functioning and still in your routine, but you're not going to be bringing the heart and passion into that marriage the way that you are supposed to because you never looked at that area of disappointment. The angel says, before you go and find Jesus, before you go in and move, I want you to see where he laid. I want you to see that emptiness. I want you to see that brokenness. I think culturally we can be so consumed with coming into church and making it seem like we have it all together that we never start to dissect the pain and the issues and the patterns that brought us into church in the first place. I want you to see that thing. God couldn't heal my life. He couldn't restore me. He couldn't place a ministry down on the inside of me until I dealt with the fact that I had shame because of a teen pregnancy. I had to see that tomb. What tombs have you learned to ignore? What issues have you learned to say, oh, it's just over. It didn't work out. It's over. And I'm just going to move on without seeing how that pain shaped me. Without seeing how that disappointment, how it changed my perspective on what I can do in life. Yeah, I used to believe that I could do all things, but now I'm a little bit concerned because I have this tomb that I haven't looked at. And so the angel tells Mary, before you move on, I want you to come see the place where the Lord lay. Because once you see it, you'll never have to see it again. That's the thing about inner healing that we like to avoid, and brokenness that we don't like to deal with, is that if you ever open it up to God fully, that he will heal it in such a way that you never have to look at it again. That means that I never have to be that broken teenage girl again because I have opened it up in such a way that God has transformed me. You will not change fully until you allow God to permeate every area of who you are, even your tombs. I don't mean your highlight reels. I don't mean the parts in your life where you were risen and got it together. But when you let God into your tombs, that's when he begins to really transform you. And so the text continues and it says, go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. Go quickly. After you've dealt with it, I'm going to accelerate the mission. He says, go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead and indeed he is going before you. Before Mary used to walk with Jesus, but now Jesus has gone ahead of her. I'm so glad that we serve a go ahead of you and walk with you kind of Jesus. That him moving doesn't mean that he leaves you completely. It means that he goes ahead of you. And I'm so glad that he went ahead of us when we came to Denver. And he went ahead of me when I was a teenage pregnant girl. And he went ahead of me when I was filing for divorce. And he said, that's all right, because that thing that I placed down on the inside of her has still been protected because he's gone ahead of me. God has gone ahead of you. And I love this. And he's going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy. What a dichotomy. Fear and great joy. Fear and great joy live in the same place when you start walking by faith. I'm excited because I got potential, but I'm afraid because I don't know how it's going to pan out. Someone's been experiencing fear and great joy, and just let this serve as your confirmation that you are on the right track. That if you have nothing but great joy, that means you're doing it within your own strength. But if you got a little bit of fear in that, then you know that you got an area where God can make up the distance. Fear is the space where God makes up the difference. Fear is the space where God makes up the difference. I want you to start inviting God into that fearful place and allow him to make up the difference so that you can move with fear and great joy. I got four points and then I'm finished on how to remain, how to keep the undefeated mentality. Number one is protect your radical. Protect it. The enemy is after your passion. So you have to stop saying you don't care when you do, or one day you won't care when you need to. Protect your radical. Sometimes it's easier to say we don't care because we don't want to risk the vulnerability that caring really costs. But when you start saying that you do care, you start thinking and operating differently. I was talking to one of my mentees, and she's in this relationship, and she's like, but I don't really care. And I'm like, stop saying that because you do care. And if you can bring yourself into the consciousness that you do care, then you will demand differently from that situation. No, you're not going to treat me any kind of way because I care. When you start making yourself recognize when you care, then you start making the situation meet that expectation because you recognize your heart is involved. Protect your radical. That's number one. Number two is expect miracles. Expect them. Come to recognize that miracles are your norms. I know it doesn't make any sense how I was able to pay all of the bills and have savings, but for some reason, miracles are my norm. I'm sorry. That's just the way my God operates. I expect miracles. Some people expect disappointment. Some people expect that things are going to go wrong. You know what I do? I expect that no weapon formed against me will prosper. I expect that though he slay me, yet shall I trust in him, because I know that all things work together for my good. I expect miracles over my children's lives. They're still young right now. They don't know who they are in the Lord, but I expect miracles over them. I expect miracles when they walk into classrooms, the kind of miracles that protects them wherever they go. That's a miracle child. That's a miracle marriage. You got to start expecting miracles. Number three, don't worry about the guard. Expect them. There will always be a guard when you're operating in radical faith. The guard is that unexpected thing that you didn't plan for at all. When you start walking in faith, just expect that there are going to be some things that happen. I don't know what they're going to be, but I'm prepared for them because I have an undefeated mindset. The guard is trying to keep you from being radical, because if it can keep you from being radical, you'll only know defeat. Number four. This is the most important. Leave the tomb. Leave the tomb. The angel told Mary to come and look in the tomb to see where the Lord lay. But the most important thing that he told her was to leave the tomb. When I was studying, I wrote down specifically, stop kissing dead things. Stop kissing dead things. It's over. It didn't work out. That chapter's come to an end. It's time to leave the tomb. It's over. It didn't work out. It's okay. God's going to make everything work together, but I'm telling you, you won't see how it's going to work out until you leave the tomb. Grab your heart back. Get your mind back in the game. It's over. It didn't work out. It's time to leave the tomb, and you're going to have to leave with fear and great joy, but it's time to leave the tomb. It's time to stop having a pity party over what didn't work out. It's time to stop talking to yourself like you're never going to be anything, and you're never going to do anything, and you're going to be just like your mother, and you're going to be just like your father. Nope, it's time to leave the tomb. That chapter of my life is over. I'm not the same insecure person that you once knew. I left the tomb. And when you leave the tomb, you're going to leave every dead thing that was in the tomb with it. What does that mean? That relationships that don't understand that you're risen will have to stay in the tomb. That situations that don't understand that you're risen are going to have to stay in the tomb. When you leave the tomb, you're going to break the mindset of dead things off of you. When you leave the tomb, you're going to break the relationships that you thought you couldn't live without, but you know don't do you any well. You're going to leave those in the tomb too. Would you stand with me as I prepare to close? Mary had to be willing to leave the tomb, the place of loss, the place of disappointment, the place where it felt like things weren't shaping up. And in order to lay hold of that next dimension of life, that next dimension of what God has for her, she had to proceed with fear and great joy. In this room, there are people on all different sides of this journey. There are some people who are like Mary Magdalene, and they're just trying to have the faith to even walk and believe that the stone will be rolled away when they get there. There are other people who have made it and the stone has been rolled away, but they see that what they prayed for wasn't exactly what they hoped it would be. They've experienced some level of disappointment. And then there are other people who are still sitting in the seat that disappointment created. They're still sitting in the seat that disappointment created in their marriage. I don't know what the issues are. Infidelity, maybe something happened. There's a trust issue when you're just sitting in the tomb. And God says that if you really want that marriage to be healed, you're going to have to leave the tomb. Leave the tomb requires forgiveness. If you really want to start that company, you're going to have to leave the tomb. You're going to have to be okay with the fact that you lost the job. You're going to have to leave the tomb that tells you that you're never going to make it. This message is for you when you have been struggling to feel undefeated in spite of your losses. I want to invite you to this altar. Because I believe that we only experience defeat when we function within our own power. But when we recognize that the only way we can become undefeated is when we partner with God, that's when we experience radical change. I want to commend the people who are at this altar because it takes courage to admit that there is a tomb in your life. And I want them to inspire that person who is still sitting in their seat, but they know that they know that they know that this message was for them. But maybe they feel too much pride. Maybe they feel like, I don't want people to know that I'm still dealing with that we're struggling. But I dare you to leave the tomb. Because the tomb creates pride. And so I'm not going to just move on with the altar call for the sake of staying on flow with the production. I will not leave until every soul who is ready to be undefeated in every area of their life is represented at this altar. I don't care who you came with. I don't care where you serve in the ministry. You being undefeated is more important than what people think about you. You coming to this altar is going to give someone the courage to say, oh man, if she can, I can too. If she can admit it, then I can admit it too. We come to church every Sunday, but nobody really wants to be radically changed. This is the moment where we demand that we become undefeated, that the church actually becomes a hospital and not a museum. There are sick people in this room who have been battling with their minds and battling with depression, and we cannot serve notice on the enemy and hide behind our pride at the same time. I want to be undefeated. It may be hard to believe because everyone thinks I'm so confident. Everyone thinks I'm so happy. But the reality is, on the inside, I feel defeated. I'm aching. I'm broken. And I used to be able to love radically, but I can't even feel my heart anymore. And I used to be able to believe radically, but I don't even know if I have faith anymore. This is a real moment. This is a real moment. These are the moments that make the enemy start getting nervous because he knows that if you would ever get undefeated for real, that his tricks and plans and plots wouldn't work anymore. I know somebody wanted to shout around the building. Maybe we'll do that next Sunday, but I am a life changer. I know what God has given me. He has given me the anointing to help people to tap into that broken part of their lives. This is not by coincidence. If you are in this room on this Sunday and I am delivering this message, it's because God wants you to connect to that tomb, to that brokenness, to that pain that you learned to masquerade. And he wants to help you overcome it. And he wants to stretch your faith and stretch your belief until you can lay hold of an undefeated mindset. Maybe you're here and you say, listen, I don't really consider myself a Christian. I don't even know if I'm saved. But I know while you were up there that something was happening on the inside of me. I felt it deep in my core. I want you to come too. Listen, we're all about relationship. This isn't about religion for us. We don't have these set of standards and these rules before you can get saved. No, we believe that we serve a God who will meet you right where you are and lead you with love and patience and kindness to where he has for you. I want to invite you here too. God wants for us to be whole. I'm reminded in the Bible, before he performed a miracle, he asked an important question, wilt thou be made whole? He's got healing for us, but do you have the hunger for it? Do you have the hunger to receive that healing? I'm going to pray in just a moment. But I just want to ask one more time. If there's anyone here, maybe they're seated in their seats. And they said, if she says it one more time, then I'll go. This is that time. I'm saying it again. Of course, I'm going to pray and the prayer is going to be all throughout the room, but I promise you there's something about leaving that seat, leaving that place where you once were, leaving that tomb and walking with vulnerability, with fear and great joy into what God has called us to do in this moment. That's what altar calls are all about. It's about leaving the tomb and walking forward with fear and great joy. I'm a little bit nervous. I don't know what this means, but I got joy because I feel like I've been seen by a precious Savior. I feel like I've been seen. So God, thank you for this ability to be seen. That some of us thought that we were just coming to be inspired, but that you have awakened something on the inside of us that makes us believe that we can be healed. If you're at the altar, I want you to lift your hands like you're going to receive something. This is the sign of surrender. This is when we offer ourselves to God as a living sacrifice. Here I am. Here I am, God. Here are my tombs. Here are my disappointments. Here are my fears. Here are the things that I thought would keep me from pursuing you, God. Here they all are, the dead things in my life that I can't leave alone, but I know aren't producing more life in me. God, I surrender those over to you right now. God, I decree and declare right now in the name of Jesus that the people represented at this altar and in this room have just tapped into a mindset of being undefeated. That as they were receiving this word, that you were breaking down barriers and strongholds. Oh God, I ask, man, if I have some believers in this room, I need you to start praying and pressing in with me on behalf of your brothers and sisters. God, I decree and declare right now in the name of Jesus that the plan that the enemy had has been rendered void. Right now in the name of Jesus, no weapon formed against them will prosper. I decree that victory is coming back to them right now, oh God, that vision is returning to them. God, make them radical. Radical like Jesus. Radical like Mary. Radical like people who believe that all things are possible. God, I ask that joy would return to them. I rebuke depression. I rebuke shame. I rebuke guilt. I rebuke any plan or thought that the enemy planted in their life. I rebuke words that were prophesied over their life that were not from you. I rebuke it and I uproot it right now in the name of Jesus. Memories of who they used to be, keeping them from becoming who you've called them to be. I rebuke it, oh God, and I render it void. May they lose it from their mind, oh God. May they lose it from their mind so that all they see is you. Take them to the cross, Jesus. Take them to the cross, Jesus, where they can see their sins dead and they can see victory rising up in them like never before. God, change our minds about our future. And help us to embrace our past so that we can make the best of our present. Oh, I'm going to say it again. God, change our minds about our future. Help us to embrace our past so that we can make the best of our present. Let there be a sense of real freedom and confidence down on the inside of us that we need and lack nothing. And that we are overflowed with the knowledge of who you are. If you would just repeat it after me. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for making him who had no sin, all of mine, all of my weaknesses, all of my limitations, all of my tombs, you placed in his body. You nailed it to the cross. And when he was risen, I was risen too, free, victorious, and undefeated. I received that, oh God. Change my mind until I am undefeated in every area, until my losses don't define me. And your grace is surrounding me. Fill me with your spirit. Take control of my mind and heal my heart. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Can you celebrate with me what God is doing? What took place in this room is what frees families for generations after generations after generations. I don't know if you know this, but our church just got stronger. Our church just got better. Our church just became undefeated. Somebody's grandchildren are going to be okay because of what took place at this altar. Don't take it for granted. Somebody just got the victory for legacy. Somebody just got the victory for generations after generations after generations after generations. After generations, after generations, after generations, you just changed the tide of your family. You just changed the tide. May the Lord bless and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious towards you. May he lift up his countenance over you and grant you shalom, shalom, in Jesus' name. See you next week. We love you so much.
Hey, my friend, I pray that that message blessed your life. It blessed me for sure. I want to also encourage you to pick up Wholeness, Winning in Life from the Inside Out. This book is going to change your life. God bless you. I'll see you next time.